While cruising towards Phnom Penh, the staff of the riverboat put on a fun show in the Saigon Lounge. We have now arrived at Phnom Penh, the capital and the largest city of Cambodia. Located on the banks of the Mekong River, Phnom Penh has a population of 2.2 million out of Cambodia's total population of 15.5 million. Double-digit economic growth rates in recent years have triggered an economic boom in Phnom Penh, which has become a modern city with new hotels, restaurants, Western-style bars, high-rises and residential buildings springing up all around the city. The main economy is based on commercial interests such as garments, trading and small and medium enterprises. Tourism is also a major contributor in the capital as more shopping and commercial centres open, making Phnom Penh one of the major tourist destinations. Today's Friday, the 2nd of November 2012, and we're in Phnom Penh, leaving our river cruise ship and getting on some buses and starting to explore the city. Our first stop is the Royal Palace, which was constructed over a century ago to serve as the residence of the King of Cambodia, his family and foreign dignitaries, and as a venue for the performance of court ceremony and ritual as a symbol of the kingdom. Okay, the palace is behind me here, and this is the main road in front of the waterway, and our river cruise ship is parked up the road there, and there's our bus that's taking us around today. We're now going to walk inside the palace.
Yes.
But we're not allowed to take pictures inside, right?
We can take photo inside.
Oh, you can take photo inside. Okay. We're now going for a 2-hour walk around the Royal Palace. Now we're going inside the Silver Pagoda. The Silver Pagoda, or the Temple of the Emerald Buddha, formerly a wooden building, was rebuilt in 1962 in concrete and marble. The pagoda is floored with 5,000 silver tiles, each weighing 1 kilo. It is famous for its 19-kilogram solid gold Buddha, made in 1907, and an emerald Buddha said to be made of barakant crystal. Sharing the pagoda are many other interesting artifacts and jewels. These structures they use to bury the ashes of the royal families. There's another one over here, you see. And now we're going back to the bus. Well, here we are in the market area of Phnom Penh, and there's all these little three-wheeler tuk-tuks there. It's very organized, very clean, and it seems very safe. This is a democratic country, not a communist country. Yeah, let's check these markets out here in Phnom Penh. This is like a flower area here. Beautiful flower arrangements, look. Let's go inside here. Okay, well, we now will go for lunch, and I'll just show you what a typical lunch is like here on the boat. It's very, very nice.
I haven't had it yet. I'm going to have it then. I'll come and tell you after lunch.
You want to see it?
Good afternoon, Frank.
And then what we're going to do is you wash your hands, you see?
Put your hands up.
Here's our little restaurant. Find our table. Here they show you what the meals are available for today. There's fish and roast duck and spaghetti. Then there's a menu you can also choose from. It's all very nice and includes free wine. Here's a buffet. Or they can cook it for you on the spot. This guy actually cooks stuff on the spot for you. Here we have some nice friends that I've met on the cruise. And there's some nice dessert over here.
The Cho Ang Ek killing fields are located about 15 kilometres outside of Phnom Penh. Well, behind me is just one of the places, or one of the monuments, of one of 300 killing fields here in Cambodia back from the 1970s. Millions of people were killed by the then Communist Party. And this is at one of the commemoration places.
The killing fields in Cambodia was caused in 1975 by the overthrow of the then USA-backed government by the Viet Cong-backed Communist Khmer Rouge, led by Pol Pot.
Walking along some stations that explain exactly what happened in these spots. This was the executioner's working office here, and the next one was the chemical substances storage room you see over there. This was an actual mass grave site right here. These were the actual mass graves here, which have been dug up. And there's actually a human bone down there. These are all ex-graves here, look. Now we're going to the killing tree. This is where they used to get babies and hit it against the tree to kill the babies. Well, this area here is, they haven't dug up any of this area, but it is definitely a grave, but they're just leaving this in peace. They're just leaving all this area here. But here, this has all been dug up here, see? Okay, we'll now go inside the monument and have a look at what exactly went on here.
The Khmer Rouge is remembered mainly for the deaths of an estimated 2 million people, or one-fifth of the country's total population, under its communist regime, through execution, torture, starvation and forced labour. This memorial is marked by a Buddhist stupa. The stupa has acrylic glass sides and is filled with more than 5,000 human skulls. Some of the lower levels are opened during the day so that the skulls can be seen directly. Many of these skulls have been smashed, and this was caused during the time of execution. This is a powerful and symbolic monument.
How do you get out?
Just
go out.
And it's just...
Why is it? Oh, it's pretty.
sad, isn't it? Okay, we're now going back into the bus for a half-hour drive to a prison that used to be a school.
To make the family. So mainly opposition guy who are from the parliament.
Okay, we're now going into the Toul Sleng Genocide Museum. Now this used to be a school. Alright, we're now in the school grounds.
Here, you can ask questions from an actual survivor and get a signed book. The buildings of Toul Sleng have been preserved as they were left when the Khmer Rouge were driven out in 1979. The Toul Sleng Museum of Genocide is a former high school building which was transformed into a torture, interrogation and execution centre between 1976 and 1979. The Khmer Rouge called the centre S21. Of the estimated 15 to 30,000 prisoners, only 7 prisoners survived. The Khmer Rouge photographed the vast majority of the inmates and left a photographic archive which enables visitors to see almost 6,000 S21 portraits on the walls. Visitors can also learn how the inmates were tortured from the equipments and facilities exhibited in the buildings.
Here they converted some rooms into little cells by building little brick walls, look. Well, today is Saturday the 3rd of November 2012 and we've left Phnom Penh and we are now at a village called Chong Poi. We're just leaving the boat, as you can see from behind me, on the gangplank.
This morning the ship docks right next to Chong Poi village, which is a handicraft centre.
We're going into a school now.
The economic activities here include planting crops such as corn, sesame, beans, bananas and planting fruit trees. They also manufacture mosquito nets, silk sarongs, and generally run small businesses. Families here have a long tradition of producing local Khmer handicrafts and of weaving. Nearly all families have their own loom, and wealthier families have multiple looms or larger looms. Locals are trying to develop their town into a tourist centre.
This is cotton. The scarves and stuff like that. Let's have a look at a house upstairs here. Fairly high up to stop any water in the flooding area at times. And see the floor here? This is inside the house. And the floor's got little gaps in between to let the air in, so it's built in air conditioning. Go back onto the boat now.
My step, please.
Well, now it's the afternoon and we're going to the next place. So this is back on the gangplank. Now we're going to get on the buses.
Mind ahead.
Okay, mind ahead.
Wow, here we go again.
Our next stop is Oudong, which is about 35 kilometres north of Phnom Penh. Oudong became the capital of Cambodia back in 1618 until 1865, when the capital was relocated to Phnom Penh. Over 100 years ago, Oudong boasted hundreds of buildings, temples and royal stupas, but most were destroyed in the early 1970s civil war. A few Buddhist monasteries have survived, along with the funerary stupas of some kings. Also, a number of buildings have been rebuilt.
Well, we're now going to be blessed by some monks. Behind me is a tomb of a mummified monk.
As we drive on, we see large garment-making factories. The garment industry has grown to the point where at peak periods, more than 400,000 people work in the factories. The garment-making industry is Cambodia's biggest employer and key export earner. And the cash which workers send home to their families has helped to improve the quality of life in rural provinces. Here we can see the transport they use to go to and from work each day. We're now at Kampong Tralag, where we will again meet up with the ship. But to get to the ship, we will travel by Oxcart ride through the Cambodian countryside.
And we're moving.
Yeah,
Here we are on the Oxcart ride. It's all good business for the locals. Okay, we've now arrived back at our river cruise boat. Great big river cruise boat just pulls up on the side of the canal, on the side of the river. Fantastic. Today is Sunday the 4th of November 2012, and happy birthday, Mum. And we're here in Kampong Changa, and we're going to visit the floating markets and see these people here. All these houses are on stilts. I will be driving around this area and watching this huge floating market.
We again leave our river cruise ship and hop on local boats who take us through the local floating village, where people live permanently in their floating houses. Kampong Chang is located geographically in the middle of Cambodia on the Mekong River, and is the last place that we will visit here on our riverboat cruise before landing at Siem Reap. Kampong Chang is a busy rural port town with bustling markets. For the people of the township shore, major flooding can occur from the Mekong River. Last year, the water rose 14 metres, causing major devastation. However, of course, those in the floating houses were only slightly affected. Here we are in the local town, where the main activity is the fish and food markets, plus there are small workshops scattered around the place. The surrounding area is rich in alluvial soil and has lots of fisheries and rice plantations. They also have fruit cropping and have several garment factories. Here we see blacksmiths at work, where they are reforging steel from pieces of old bombs they found. This is local beer. Little local little restaurant. Yeah, that's a boy can be the man. They can be 6 7. Well, from the Mekong River here, going into the Toul Sleng Genocide Museum. We are now on Cambodia's great Toul Sleng Lake. Toul Sleng Lake is the most prominent feature on the map of Cambodia, a huge dumbbell-shaped body of water stretching across the northwest section of the country. In the wet season, Toul Sleng Lake is one of the largest freshwater lakes in Asia, swelling to an expansive 12,000 square kilometres. During the dry half of the year, the lake shrinks to as small as 2,500 square kilometres. The lake is also an important commercial resource, providing more than half of the fish consumed in Cambodia.
Well, this is the last night of our cruise. We're sitting here having dinner with all these wonderful people here that I've met. And there's going to be a special dessert occasion. So we're just waiting in anticipation. There's our dessert.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Tola, with the dessert. Okay. Thank you. Well, from our boats here, we are transferring to the buses. There to take us to Siem Reap.
We have now arrived at the Le Meridian Angkor Hotel in Siem Reap. Siem Reap is the gateway for visiting the famous Angkor ruins, which are about 6 kilometers north of the city and is probably the most tourist-orientated city in Cambodia. Siem Reap is a modern, clean and safe city where, for a few dollars, you can hire a tut-tut to take you anywhere in town.
Well, we're now going to visit Angkor Thom over here. This one here. Now, we've received these passes here with our photos on. They're good for 3 days while we're here.
Here we are at one of 5 gates which leads onto a causeway across the moat. It's flanked with statues of 54 gods on the left and 54 demons on the right. This is a theme from a Hindu myth. This is the entrance to the famous Bayon Temple, which is a Buddhist temple, but retains elements of Hindu cosmology and imagery, and is famously known for its multiple smiling faces. The Bayon Temple stands in the exact center of the walled city. It represents the intersection of heaven and earth. Angkor Thom was built in a nearly perfect square. It was surrounded by a square wall 8 meters high and 12 kilometers in length, and further protected by a 100 meter wide moat. It has an area of 9 square kilometers compared to the Angkor Wat, which is 1 square kilometer. The city of Angkor Thom was founded by Angkor's greatest king in the 12th century, and at its height, Angkor Thom may have governed a population of 1 million people in the surrounding area. The incredible stone structures are just amazing.
So we're on the third level now. Face. Today is Tuesday, the 6th of November 2012, and we're here at the Angkor Wat, ready to watch the sunrise over the Angkor Wat. And it's a early in the morning, but it's beautiful, it's nice and cool, because through the day it's quite hot.
We're going up to the up into the first level now. Yeah. Well, it's early in the morning here, and we're in front of a big pond in front of the main entrance of the Angkor Wat. But look at all the people here. Thousands of people, and it's early in the morning. It's a big tourist attraction for Cambodia, this is. And we walk from the entrance over there, all the way along the main entrance, right here, and we're waiting here for the sunrise. Above the reflection of the water pool. So now we're having a nice cup of tea and a biscuit in front of the Angkor Wat here. Here we are in front of the Angkor Wat. What did you think of it, all right?
Oh, absolutely wonderful.
Close to a million people visit the ruins of Angkor each year, and for good reason. Located to the north of Cambodia near Siem Reap, this is without much doubt Cambodia's number one attraction and one of the most amazing places in the world. There are over 1,000 temples in Angkor, ranging from little more than piles of rubble to the amazing Angkor Wat. These ruins are one of the most famous in the world. Once a mighty force in Southeast Asia, the Khmer People's Empire dates back to the year 802. The city of Angkor stood at the center of the then mighty Hindu Empire. It grew and became the largest known pre-industrial settlement, spanning a massive 3,000 square meters, roughly the equivalent of Los Angeles. Angkor Wat, the main temple in the Angkor region, was built during the early 12th century as a personal mausoleum for the king at the time and was dedicated to the Hindu god Vishnu. Later, after various wars and a new king, the Khmer Empire transitioned from Hinduism to Buddhism, which has remained as the principal religion of Cambodia. The Angkor region has hundreds of monuments that contain more stone than the Egyptian pyramids and cover more ground than modern Paris. Angkor was the capital of an empire that once controlled most of Southeast Asia. But more than 500 years ago, the Khmer people fled this grand city. To the outside world, this city only existed in obscure travelers' tales. Then, in 1860, a French naturalist stumbled across the ruins.
Well, here's a huge gallery of carvings on the wall.
He wrote about the city and drew it, attracting the attention of the wider world. But the questions had just begun. Who were the Angkor's builders and the empire called the Khmer? And why had the city been abandoned? Archaeologists and historians have pieced together the story. Angkor's greatest marvel, the Angkor Wat, served as a shrine, observatory and funerary temple. Research suggests it took almost 30 years to complete and was finished in time to bury an important king. But Angkor Wat had hardly claimed its place on the horizon when disaster struck. Drawn by its increasing splendor, the Champs, what is now Vietnam, attacked and burned the city. When the capital was rebuilt, the king built a walled city, Angkor Thom, to protect them in time of war. But the Khmer story came to an end not long afterward. 22 kings over 500 years had worked the land until it began to fail. Rice harvest stopped and stone monument building ceased.
Okay, we'll be going up the top level where the gods are up there, up these stairs, and we'll get a nice view of the Angkor Wat.
Early in the 15th century, the Kingdom of Siam made profitable raids into Khmer territory, and a climatic battle around 1431 brought about the end.
Okay, we're now at the top level. These are the original steps. Okay, well that's the Angkor Wat. And now we're going back to the hotel for breakfast.
We are now at another temple called Ta Prom, which was built as a Buddhist monastery and university. Unlike most Angkorian temples, Ta Prom has been left by archaeologists in much the same condition in which it was found. The photogenic and atmospheric combination of trees growing out of the ruins and the jungle surroundings have made it one of Angkor's most popular temples with visitors. Here we can see a good example of how the abandoned Khmer city went into centuries-long sleep and was gradually taken over by the rainforest, until 1860, when Westerners came and looted many of the relics from the temples for museums or private collections. A long restoration process was started in 1907 and saw large areas of forest cleared and foundations repaired. This process was stopped in 1970 when the Cambodian Civil War made aid workers flee the country. During the Civil War, there was intense fighting even in the temples.
Look at the size of this tree here. Look at the roots.
The temple of Ta Prom was used as a location in the famous film Tomb Raider.
What a fantastic place. And think of all the history that's here. And here we have the Australian Tomb Raiders. And there's some more there.
Today, the process of restoration continues, even with up to 1 million visitors a year coming to see the ancient city of Angkor and all its other temples in the surrounding area. Thank you.
Thank you.